It's always good to come back to Canada because we always, in the States, look to Canada as blazing some pathways we'd like to blaze. And that has been going on for over 100 years. I mean, you came down and taught us how to form credit unions over 100 years ago. We now have 75 million Americans who belong to credit unions. And certainly, Tommy Douglas started something here with Medicare, which we still have. Close to in the state. So it's a little worrisome that trajectory is beginning to turn around under your present government. And we hope that we can work together so we can pull each other up. I think the two countries now need each other in more ways than one. Years ago, I was amazed at how modest Canadians are. So put together this book, Canada First. All the ways Canada was first, and we sent it to a dozen publishers or so, and they all turned it down because they said, Canadians not interested, they're too modest. I said, for heaven's sake, half of this book, Texas First, would have been a bestseller. So that's why we did it, because Canadians are too modest. And it started because in gatherings in various provinces, the people in the audience couldn't come up with more than 20 examples of where Canadians were first. And this is just the first of two books. I did it with Duff Conacher, my niece, Nader, and Ona. So it's an eye-opener for Americans and people from the U.S., but also here in Canada. Finally, a publisher published it, Clement Stewart, which is a big publisher, and it was a 43-week paperback bestseller in 1993. And I did it in part for us back in the States to see how a much smaller country broke so much ground, not just in technology, sports, arts, but also in social innovation. First Children's Theater, for example. Many innovations like that. So just give me an idea. How many students in the audience here? Can you see your hand? Okay. How many of you have never been to a mall, or a McDonald's, or a Walmart? Okay. Now let me ask you a question. How many of you have never been as a visitor, spectator, in a court of law here in Canada? Never been in a court of law? How many of you have never been to a city council meeting, if that's what you call it here? And how many of you have never been to a prison? You have seven of them here. Now you see the point I'm trying to make, which is in the commercial arena, there's things you want to buy and eat, and you're there. But in the public, civic, governmental arenas, where people are making decisions for you, I don't mean for you, you know, they're making decisions on you under the influence of some pretty powerful commercial interest, you're not there. And I must say, my parents deliberately took us to courtrooms and to town meetings and gatherings. They weren't didn't you know, say, you will, you know, do this and that when you grow up. They just wanted us to go along with them and soak it up. So that's where it starts. And all the way through college, graduate school, if you're not careful, the courses will be heavily vocational. Business school, engineering, you know, the professions. They'll be very vocational. And you won't have many humanities and social sciences. They're sort of like poor cousins now in higher education. They're not considered functional for job seeking, and they're almost considered just an indulgence. However important they may be. And I always tell people in the States, listen, in 1787, when those 100 people came to Philadelphia and drafted our Constitution in that hot summer, in that big room, not one of them was a stagecoach mechanic. Although they might not have got there at the top without the stagecoach. But they were steeped in jurisprudence, comparative politics, philosophy, literature. And so without that, we don't scale to a higher level of our own significance. We just don't. It doesn't matter how brilliant you are if you are specialized in a particular area, whether it's physics or engineering or whatever, medicine, law. You will narrow the scope of your significance because you will not be taking into account the seamless web that is a society. As a result, you'll shrug your shoulders when one challenge or one exhortation comes to you after another because you say, well, I'm only a molecular biologist. I'm only a computer software designer. So you're not a whole person. And that's why it's so important in school to teach practical civics connecting the classroom and the community. So you really understand the reality of a community and its virtues and its deprivations, its problems, challenges, successes. And you integrate it as part of your knowledge. And one nice thing about practical civics, it draws on every discipline ever conceived in a university, including art. Every discipline is relevant to pursuing the role of a citizen. And so you're not starting out very propitiously because even here in Canada, there is a heavy emphasis on vocational education, non-controversial education. And I know when I was growing up, I realized when I became about 20 years old that I was trained in the schools, I was educated at home, and I was engrossed in the library. Those are the three. And so it's good to start out breaking all self-censorship and low estimates of how influential you can all be to transform our country world. You got to break through, otherwise the lucrative temptations will trivialize your skills you graduate with. And to make perhaps an extreme example, I was once at a food technology show, and they had prizes, big, big convention center. And a chemist received a prize for creating a special kind of artificial whipped cream for a bakery product. The cigarette. And how many lawyers spend their lives in trivial parsing of tax loopholes for their corporate clients? And on and on. So if you don't come out with a public philosophy, you will not have an absorptive capacity to challenge all your talents on things of real importance. And the most important work in this world of ours is not going to be done by corporations or government. At the outset, it's going to be done by citizens. They may then pressure business, government, labor unions, whatever, to do these things. For example, the pressure of environmentalism to push for renewable fuels is the predicate of the nascent solar energy industry. So, solar energy has been around for years, centuries. Ancient Persia and Athens had passive solar architecture. East Africa, 2,000 years ago, had tunnels using cooling winds coming off the Red Sea. It's been around for years, but it was pretty much supplanted by wood, and then coal, and oil, gas, you know the story. And now, the rise of environmental values and the evidence behind it are providing a good push for the solar energy business. So that's what values do. And I remember in 1970, when first Earth Day in the United States, I think it spilled over to Canada, there were 1,500 college campuses and universities on the same day in April, Earth Day. And they put the environmental on the map from which they never left. It was led with evening television network news. It was on the cover of Time, Newsweek, etc. And what caused that? And what happened as a result? Well, some interesting lessons. About 20 million people showed up for those 1,500 events. That was three of them in one day. I mean, it's really quite April 22, I think it was, 1970. That created a huge media establishing the Environmental Protection Agency, the Occupational Safety and Health Agency, and a whole bevy of smaller pieces of legislation. Had we delayed, had we said, let's build it, let's wait, the corporations would have counterattacked. That's just exactly what happened when Harry Truman proposed full health insurance for all Americans in 1946. We haven't got it yet. In fact, 800 Americans die every week, according to Harvard Medical School researchers, because they can't afford health insurance to get diagnosed and treated. That's 800 a week, that's 25,000 a year. That's over. That's 15 9/11s. Every year, not to mention injuries and illnesses. So that's because it was stretched out. And the health insurance companies, drug companies, they knew how to game the political system to put their lobbyists up on Capitol Hill. So just imagine how little effort it took, but it was coordinated and organized in 1970 to provide the legal architecture for the modern progress in environmental health and safety. Of course, then the corporations counterattacked, and they've been trying to whittle it down, and subject to atrophy. So it's been a constant struggle, as I'm sure you've experienced. But the lesson here is this, that we have the power, that we have to organize it, that we have to spend an extraordinary little amount of money and time if we have millions of people organized. And if we can overcome all these powerful corporations and their indentured politicians, there's no question about it. It has happened again and again when people organize, because the politicians and the corporations have a secret they don't want to tell you, and that is, they're scared stiff of you. And the Occupy movement, in effect, produced a lot more underarm deodorant purchases on Capitol Hill and Wall Street last fall. And now they're wondering whether it's going to renew itself and come in even bigger. But you know how many people were involved in the whole Occupy movement in the United States? That included marches, demonstrations, and encampments. We have 315 million people, men, women, and children. 250,000. Because they, first of all, showed real determination. It wasn't a three-hour march. It was 24/7. Second, they were reflecting what Abraham Lincoln called the public sentiment of a majority of the people, with their 99% slogan, and inequality, and there's a lot of it here in Canada. So this is the most important thing to keep in mind, because if we go through life recognizing accurately that large global corporations control too much of our politics, of our education, of our childhood, commercializing childhood, of our food, of our public budget allocations, et cetera, et cetera. And stop there, we will make an irresistible excuse for ourselves going no further. They're too powerful. In the States, you know, you can't fight City Hall, can't fight ExxonMobil. And so, in effect, we've opted out. We've won for that. History shows a very small number of people, determined, accurate, organized, representing large amounts of public opinion, can change to the level of transformative change. And in recent decades, we have been making excuses for ourselves because these large corporations have gotten more powerful, and they've gotten more powerful because we think they're more powerful, and therefore give up on ourselves in making ourselves powerful. So we're the reciprocal. That's what gives them their power. And they know. Don't think they don't know. This book, Only the Super Rich Will Say This, that I wrote, analyzes that whole psychology and how to take it on. Even though it's political fiction, there's a lot of reality in the book. So when it comes to, you know, trying to communicate with people who are of fine intentions and great humanity and very refined sense of justice, it's civic motivation, isn't it? I mean, most of you have been involved in civic activities. I mean, the adults here. And how many times do you have to call people, beg them to come to a march and a demonstration and a meeting, even though they agree with you and they think something needs to be done? And they say, well, I'm too busy and I've got this appointment or whatever. Point is, we can never be too busy for democracy. Because if we're too busy for democracy, we get autocracy. And if we get autocracy, yeah, we're going to be really busy trying to make ends meet, live through all kinds of injustices, obstructions, irritations, anguish, traffic jams, and all the rest. I want to give just three quick stories to lay the basis here as to the kind of qualities that are needed to deal not only with going green, going justice. Heraclitus, the ancient philosopher, once said, character is destiny. That so took me, that phrase, that I added a couplet to it. Character is destiny, personality is decisive. When some of you come back from your reunions, and 20, 30 years from now, back to Queens, you will wonder why your classmates differentiated themselves so vastly in what they achieved and didn't achieve. Because you thought they were all pretty alert and smart and got good grades and so on. Well, some of it is bad luck. But a lot of it is just the personality. One personality is resilient. One personality refuses to be disturbed. One personality shares the credit, therefore builds more of a community. Another personality may not. One personality can take criticism and say, terrific, give me more. It makes me stronger. Another personality is blistered by moonbeams, very unable to take criticism, and therefore grow. So, character is destiny, and personality is decisive. Now, here's three little interesting stories. Isaac Newton, the famous British physicist, a scientist, was once asked at a gathering the following by a person, Mr. Newton, why are you so much more brilliant than your other fellow scientists? And Newton replied, I'm not so much more brilliant than my other fellow scientists. I just have the capability of holding a problem in my mind and concentrating on it longer than most of them. So the word is concentration. The second that comes from Einstein, maybe you can understand that. He said, quote, I have no special gifts. I only have a passionate curiosity. He is curiosity. He was very big on that. In fact, he said curiosity is more important than knowledge, by which he meant it produces more knowledge. And then William Blake, great literary virtuoso, England, a couple centuries ago, was at a party and someone came up to him, Mr. Blake, with whom are you living these days? And Mr. Blake responded, with whom am I living? I'm living with my imagination. So you have concentration, curiosity, imagination. You got to carry those through. Because the nature of culture is conformity. It puts the blinders on. And with specialization, you become sharp by becoming more narrow. So culture has a lot of benefits too, but one of them that is not so beneficial is if you allow it to conform you, to cripple your curiosity, your imagination, and therefore divert your concentration on matters of great importance. Now, let's take the subject at hand here. We've made a good deal of progress in terms of creating more humane technologies. At the same time, we're creating more threatening technologies. Nanotechnology and biotechnology are moving very quickly, and they are without any legal or ethical framework in our country. There's no regulation to speak of. Monsanto does what it wants. It controls the seed, the genetically planted crops on a neighboring farm through the air, landed on his land, and Monsanto sued him for patent infringement. Remember that one? Some of you? Yeah. He has since taken on Monsanto worldwide. We gave him a prize a couple years ago for civic heroism. And so what we've seen here, there is less lead now in our bodies because we got rid of leaded gasoline and leaded paint. When we talk about toxics and pollution, notice the change in imagery and language. Back in 1970, people would look at an industrial plant and stuff going through a smokestack, look at all that. So they'd say. And then recently they said, look at all that pollution. That's an important change in language. And because it recognizes something that's an incredible deficiency in modern culture. And that is how violence is defined. Pollution is nothing more than a silent, cumulative form of violence. It produces cancer, lung disease, liver disease, genetic damage, property damage, you name it. But society focuses overwhelmingly on anthropomorphic form of violence. Muggings, rapes, wars, terror. When you add it up, though, the institutional violence is far greater than street violence. In our country, these are official figures, 16,000 homicides a year, last year, 58,000 workplace-related disease and trauma deaths, 58,000, 65,000 deaths in air pollution, some of them are